Good afternoon, everyone. How are you today? Are you all set? Okay, here we go. Emmy and Tony Award winner David Hyde Pierce can currently be seen on Broadway, starring opposite Sigourney Weaver and Kristine Nielsen in Christopher Durang's new comedy, Vanya and Sonia and Masha and Spike. The show opened in March following sold-out runs at Princeton's McCarter Theater and at Lincoln Center. Pierce made his professional and Broadway debut in 1982 in Durang's Beyond Therapy and went on to create roles in off-Broadway productions of Mark O'Donnell's That's It, Folks, Richard Greenberg's The Author's Voice, and Jules Feiffer's Elliot Loves, before returning to Broadway in The Heidi Chronicles. In 2005, Pierce originated the role of Sir Robin in the Broadway production of Monty Python's Spamalot and was nominated for a Drama Desk Award. In 2007, he won the Tony Award and earned another Drama Desk Award nomination for his role in the musical comedy Curtains. Perhaps best known for his role of Niles Crane on TV's iconic comedy Frasier, which ran for 11 seasons. He earned 4 Emmy Awards among many other accolades. His film credits include Little Man Tate, Sleepless in Seattle, Nixon, Down with Love, and the Sundance Film Festival selection, The Perfect Host. Please welcome David Hyde Pierce.
Good to see you. Here you are. This is for you, sir.
Thank you. Oh, thank you. How are you guys?
Thank you for braving the rain today. Don't you love these waters? Look at these. NYIT Auditorium on Broadway. We love these.
Bottled at the source.
Exactly. Well, first off, welcome back to Broadway.
Thank you.
With Vanya and Sonia and Masha and Spike. Great title.
Yes.
How does it feel to be
No one can remember it. Anyone who says, oh, I loved you I loved your play. That's what they say.
How does it feel to be back?
It's great to be back. As you said in your introduction, I started out on Broadway. My very first job was on Broadway. My very first job was a Chris Durang play. So there's something wonderful about having been through whatever I've been through since then and being back. But also, in the larger sense, I'm back. My partner and I sold our home in L.A. I've been mainly working here. I've been exclusively working here, basically, since Frasier ended. And it is home, and it feels like home. And the great thing about the world of Broadway is it's a family. It's a group of people that you work with over and over again or run into on the street. I have so many. My dresser, Jeannie, on Vanya was my dresser on Curtains and my dresser on Spamalot and on and on and on like that. And I walk by the Hirschfeld Theater where Kinky Boots is on now and a lot of the crew guys I know. And so it just is just feels like I'm home.
Yeah. This play has had quite a journey to Broadway. Talk about its journey.
Well, initially, the biggest part of the journey was before I ever became involved with it, because it's been about 6 years in the making. And it was started as a commission from the McCarter Theater in Princeton. And Chris Durang has a long relationship with them. And as it got closer and closer to becoming a full production, they partnered with Lincoln Center for the development of the actual piece, which we did in the summer. And we had a wonderful adventure in Princeton. It's a great cast, first of all. It's in terms of not only their talent, but also their affability. I've worked many times with the director, Mike Nichols, and he has a rule, which is no assholes. And I completely subscribe to that. You can find talented people in the world, and you don't have to put up with a lot. So that's nice. So this great group of people, and we were started out commuting to Princeton for rehearsal, and it's not a long commute, but inevitably coming back, we hit the Lincoln Tunnel traffic, which is a nightmare. And you'd get back in an hour, and then sit for 3 hours waiting to come into the city. So we all decided, pretty much collectively, to just stay out there. And we started rehearsal in August, so it was like summer camp. We bonded. We did rehearsal. We'd walk. You know, it's such a beautiful town. The students weren't there yet because it was summer, so we thought it was our town. And we went out drinking after the show. Kristine, Nielsen, and Sigourney and I, as the show went into production, we were in the fall. We went apple picking at the orchards out there. We have great pictures of Sigourney doing obscene things with pumpkins. And and the play that we're doing is a play about family, especially these three siblings and how their lives are changed by various things that happen. So that imperceptible work, that bonding work that we got to do is a real important part of the chemistry and the alchemy and the tapestry. That's so good. I just came up with those three right in a row of what people experience when they come to the show. And so I think that along with our working on the play itself and figuring out how to do that has been that sort of unconscious, I can't call it work, play that we've been able to do.
Well, how do you describe the play?
When we opened, we got, of course, lots of reviews. And I read all the reviews.
Do you?
I used to not read reviews. I went through a long period of not reading reviews. And then starting with Curtains, where I was really for the first time the lead of a company. And I remember my agent called me the night after it opened and said something like, well, she was talking about the New York Times. And she said, well, they liked you. And I thought, okay, what does that mean? And I agonized about it because I wasn't going to read it. And then I thought, well, wait a minute. I'm the head of this company. I need to know what they said. I need to know if anybody got savaged. Maybe they didn't read, and I'm not going to say anything. But if someone's wounded, I have an obligation to know. So I read the review, and it was actually a pretty good review. And I realized, I can't go on someone else's interpretation, because I've also had the experience, any of you who are actors who've been reviewed, of someone saying, you got a great review in the whatever, and you read it, and it's a great review, except it says, David Hyde Pierce sucked. And somehow they missed that when they were recommending it to you to read. So then what I decided was, if I'm going to read one review, I have to read them all. Because it's no matter how big the publication or the site, it's one opinion. And by reading them all, you really do get an interesting perspective on the thing. So why am I telling you about why am I reading reviews? What was your question about? You don't know.
I have no idea.
Okay.
Oh, tell us about the play.
I'll tell you about the play. So one of my favorite reviews, Michael Feingold in The Village Voice started out his review, which was basically a favorable review, said the difference between critics and an audience is that critics have an obligation to tell you what this thing is. Audiences don't have that obligation. They just are able to go and watch the show. And he went on to say, the hard thing is telling you what this thing is, because it's a Chris Durang play. And the genius of Christopher is that he is sui generis. He is unique. There is no one like him. No one writes like him, including himself. He changes. He evolves. And this piece, I would say, without sounding too pretentious, it's like when you start getting into The Tempest and King Lear with Shakespeare after you've done sort of comedy of errors and stuff like that. You recognize it's the same, well, unless you're Mark Rylance and don't believe it's the same writer. You recognize that it's the same person writing because you should see the strains and the seeds that have come before, but it's a much different, more mature, nuanced piece, and that's what this is. And this is one contrast, I would say. Chris wrote some very funny parodies of plays. He did a parody of Glass Menagerie called For Whom the Southern Bell Tolls, which is hysterical, but it's a parody. Very clear, funny parody. You need to know the play, and it's just, I remember, I actually did the first reading of it, and I played Lawrence, instead of Laura, who has a collection of glass swizzle sticks. And is oblivious to the fact that they're all identical. They're just swizzle sticks, but he has a different name for each one, and it drives his mother insane. So that was that level of comedy. This piece is based on the writings of Anton Chekhov and based on all of Chekhov's plays, but it's not a parody. It is, Chris describes it as he put all of the plays in a blender and sort of this is what came out of it. It's what makes it, in my mind, a great play is that the connection between Chris and Chekhov is not simple or clear. It's suffused with the atmosphere and the life and the comedy and the pathos of Chekhov. It occasionally does parody Chekhov, uses some of the lines or skews some of the lines for anyone who knows it and is interested. But it's just, and it's about well, all the things that Chekhov is about, amazingly so, because it's about a family dealing with change in exactly the same way that, say, The Cherry Orchard is about a family dealing with the change in the world. It's about someone being aware of the change in the climate and what's happening to the globe in exactly the same way that in Uncle Vanya. He has the maps of the forest and saying, look at what's happening to the world. Look at how we're deforesting and all the animals have no place to go. So these things that are so particular to Chekhov, the reason Chekhov is continuing to be done is that they're universal themes. And the reason that I think Chris's play, Chris is usually an off-Broadway playwright. In fact, my first experience with him was on Broadway and it lasted about 2 weeks and died. The reason this play has been successful wherever it's been done and continues to thrive on Broadway is it has a kind of humor, but also a kind of meaning and touches on things that have such wide appeal and catch something in the audience.
I think it's the perfect ensemble.
Yes,
How many people have seen Vanya? Well, the rest of you have plenty of time to go. You got a few more weeks to go, right?
Yes, it's scheduled to run through June 30th, and it will, but I mean, it could go beyond that, yeah.
But I really think it's a perfect ensemble. Talk about the people you knew before, and the newcomers are wonderful in this show.
Yeah, it's a great mix. So it's half and half, old people and young people. So it's me, Sigourney Weaver, and Kristine Nielsen are the elders, and all of us have a very long history with Chris Durang. Sigourney started out at the Yale Drama School with Chris. They were contemporaries, and she did his very earliest sort of cabaret stuff, and they've been pals and collaborators for years. And Kristine Nielsen, if you don't know her, she's a phenomenon and a comic genius and a wonderful actress and a hoot to play with. And she also has done many, I think she's done five of Chris's plays, Betty Summer Vacation and Miss Witherspoon and... So you have that team, and we're the siblings. And then there's this kid, Billy Magnuson, who plays Sigourney's boy toy. Sigourney plays she's the success in the family who became a famous actress who has a big movie career and five failed marriages. And she comes home to our surprise, and even more to our surprise, she comes home with this young 27-year-old kid in tow. And when you see the show, this guy, Billy Magnuson, he's playing sort of a dumb blonde honk who takes his clothes off a lot. And I can hear people, buying tickets already, that thing. But the thing you have to recognize about this actor is he is a highly trained, wonderful, inventive, brilliant actor and collaborator. Part of his brilliance is you don't get that when you're watching it. You just think, oh, this is so funny. But after you go away from the play and you think about what the part could have been, how one note it could have been, you'll realize, and this is a kid who studied commedia and taught mask work in Singapore. I mean, he so does not look like the actor that he is. And so that's one character. Shalita Grant, a recent Juilliard graduate, plays our, Kristine and my, housekeeper, Cassandra, who is a psychic, and is constantly predicting disaster and doom, which is so annoying for my character, Vanya, because I believe that the world's going to end at any minute. So to have a housekeeper confirming that repeatedly is just a lot to deal with. And she also, she's inspired, it's another character that could easily have gone wrong. And Shalita's been involved since the very early readings of the play because when she was at Juilliard, Chris Durang teaches at Juilliard, and Shalita, they sometimes wrangle some of the acting students to help perform in the playwriting class so that the playwrights will have guinea pigs on which to, perform experiments. And so she was one of those guinea pigs, and she's phenomenal. And then Genevieve Angelson, who plays her character's Nina, and much like Nina in The Seagull, she's this sort of ethereal, waif-like, naive, aspiring actress. And so you have this sort of darkened, saddened, experienced, wizened, crabby three of us, and then you have wacky Cassandra, and you have sort of big dumb Spike, and this sort of floating nymph, Nina, and you throw them all together, and it works out well.
And it makes a perfect evening of theater.
It's a pretty great night, yeah,
it's
I have
pretty
to
great.
Say.
Your character, Vanya, is this calm, cool, and collected man who really is the voice of reason.
Yes.
Yes. And then towards the end of the play has this explosive meltdown, or what I call more of a breakthrough. How do you view it?
I think that's an excellent way to describe it. People who come to the play, I think one of the reasons they enjoy it is they recognize the family dynamics. And Vanya is the peacemaker in the family. And I think Chris, by the way, wrote the role for himself to play originally. And he said, I think this is accurate, he said after he had written it, in fact, when watching us all in rehearsal, he realized and recognized that that was a role he played in his own family, the peacemaker. He didn't know he was writing that at the time, but that's, and so you've got these two sisters who are constantly at each other, very jealous and competitive. And so they are all, as a family, dealing with the loss of their parents, who passed away recently after 15 years of a downhill slide into Alzheimer's, and dealing with the what you're left with when the hub of the wheel is gone, essentially. And I'm the peacemaker, but also it's a role that you sort of put on yourself. People sometimes sort of identify, oh, I'm the calm one, I'm the quiet one, and it becomes a responsibility as well as a normal function, a sort of innate function. And as things get more and more complicated and intense, as these new influences come in, the character is gay, and so the presence of this young boy toy of hers is hugely conflicting because Vanya's 57, has basically been home his whole life with his sister. I think probably has resigned himself to never ever having love. And to have this sort of, you know, burning presence in the house, that's very disorienting. Then you have Cassandra, who, as I've said, is constantly predicting doom and destruction, and suddenly her predictions in the play are very pointed about losing the house and about things happening to us, and she starts to mention names that we've never heard of, and then Sigourney's character Masha comes in and mentions, oh, she has a new assistant, and that's the name that the assistant has. So suddenly these vague and kind of spooky and a little bit ridiculous predictions are hitting close to home. And then the Nina comes in, and she's the other catalyst, which she's someone who, unlike anyone else in the play, is supportive and encouraging and nurturing. And Vanya is a secret writer, and she somehow intuits that and encourages him to explore that artistic side of himself. So it's a character who thought everything was settled, is absolutely petrified by the idea of change. And of course, the one thing that we have to depend on is that there's going to be change, you know, and yet he can't face that. So while he's being the calm one, all these fires are being stoked throughout the play. And finally, near the end of the play, he is mad as hell and just can't take it anymore. And off he goes in his breakdown, which is, as you said, also a breakthrough. It's a thing of discovery and self-evaluation and sort of immolation and assessment of all of world culture. Yeah.
Because I love that Chris has given all of you these incredible monologues that just let your characters explode and do what they have to do. That's, I think, the brilliance of this play.
Well, he's such a generous writer.
Yeah.
And he also wrote Christine's role for her, and he wrote Sigourney's role for her. But what he's given us all, so Sigourney has fantastic sort of aria when she comes swanning in about what her life is like and what her terrible problems are. Spike has a wonderful audition piece that Sigourney's character has coached him on, and he performs it for all of us, and it's just horrifying. And Cassandra has all these perhaps the most quintessential, some of the most quintessential Christopher Durang writing, which is these crazy spoutings of quasi-Greek tragic chorus-like predictions that are just such a, you know, mashup of weird modern references and ancient texts, and it leaves everyone, including the audience, with their jaw dropped. And Nina gets to perform Vanya's version of the play that Constantine writes in The Seagull, which is, of course, Chris Durang's version of that play. And yeah, and like, that's everybody, right? Oh, and then Kristine, oh my God. Sonia has a phone call, which I won't tell you more than that, because for those of you who haven't seen the show, except to say that it is already being and will continue to be done in acting classes around the world for the rest of time. It's one of the great speeches, and she delivers it so beautifully. It's a wonderful. So yeah, Chris has given us all our moment.
If you haven't gone, it's one of the finest nights you will spend in the theater, not only to watch the play, but to watch this ensemble cast work and do what they do best. Seriously.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, and can I say about that, one of the things, when people who see the play frequently talk to me about the rant that I have at the end, and they say, oh my gosh, once you read that speech, you must have been dying to do this play. And the reality is, there's a scene at the very beginning of the play is just me and Kristine Nielsen, Vanya and Sonia, sitting and having coffee and talking. And it is so brilliantly and beautifully written that that was the thing. When I read that, I thought, oh, I cannot wait to just sit on a stage with a wonderful actor like Kristine and do this. And it's so much fun, and it just brings the audience right into the fabric of these people's lives, and it's also really funny, and off we go.
You have a great director, too, with Nicholas Martin.
Yes, Nicky Martin, who I had heard a lot about. So many of my friends, Deb Monk and Victor Garber, had worked with Nicky, Nathan Lane. Yeah. Nicky did that beautiful production of Butley. I don't know if anybody got to see that, but yeah. You know, and that's one, see, speaking of critics, I'll just say now, I saw that production, and Nathan was so brilliant mm-hmm. in it. And I mean, just incredible. And he was not, you know, the Nathan from The Producers. And the reviews that I can remember fell into two camps. One, oh, there he goes doing his same old thing again. Or two, he's not really as good as when he's doing his same old thing. And I thought, oh, you know, fuck you.
Exactly.
He was brilliant. And I wish, I'm hoping, I don't know how much, if you all know about this Iceman Cometh that Nathan did in Chicago, that I believe is planning to cometh to New York, maybe to BAM or something like that. I don't know if that's definite, but I didn't get to see it, but I heard it was amazing, and I think, you know, that'll be maybe, hopefully, the thing that will get those people to change their minds, if we care.
Yeah. Exactly. You know, you made your Broadway debut, you talked about, in 82 in Chris's Beyond Therapy. Preview audiences loved the show, didn't they?
Yeah, that whole journey is pretty amazing. In fact, it's so good, I'm going to take my coat off. Hold on.
Yeah. Get comfortable. That's what we do here. It's hot in here, right?
It's the tension. That's good.
Much better. All right. Now it looks like hee-haw. I'll tell you, do you have a lot of questions about Beyond Therapy? Because I can kind of give you the whole scoop in it.
Yeah.
Well, so I come to New York, fresh out of college. I was going to go to drama school, and great actor, Edward Herman, who I'd worked with up at Williamstown, said, you know, you've been in school now for 4 years. Why don't you go to New York and see if you even want to do this for a living before you spend any more time or money in drama school? And so I came to New York, and he set up a general audition with the casting director. And this was in, I don't know, September. And around December, the same casting director brought me in to read for this play, Beyond Therapy, part of The Waiter. And I came in and read, and it was Chris Durang, and John Madden was the director. John, who directed Shakespeare in Love, you know, but was also a theater director at that time. And did the audition and got the part. And I thought, September, October, November, December, in May, I'm going to open on Broadway. I can't believe this. And it was John Lithgow, Diane Wiest, Kate McGregor Stewart, and Peter Michael Getz. I don't know if you know, but three names is always a good sign. And Jack Gilpin. And so we started rehearsal, and my part, if you don't know the play, there are many scenes that happen at a restaurant between the lead couple, Bruce and Prudence, I think it is, John Lithgow and Diane Wiest. And part of the running jokes is, no matter how many times they go to this restaurant, no waiter ever shows up. At one point, Prudence even says, maybe they don't even have waiters at this restaurant, I don't know. So at the end of the play, and then almost the last scene, there's a huge conflagration where all the characters end up in the restaurant at the same time, and one of them even brings a gun and fires it, and there's pandemonium, and they all end up under the table. There's a pause, and then the doors open, and a waiter comes in. It's me, and I said, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to ask you to leave. That's the first line. So because it's at the end of the play, I was there sitting through the early rehearsals for probably a week and a half before I got to go on. And of course, I was a young actor just absorbing everything I could from these amazing people watching them. So finally, we get to the point where I say my first line. And I said, I'm sorry, I'll have to ask you to leave. And they all fell out of their chairs laughing. They thought it was so funny. And then I found out that John Lithgow had passed a note around to the cast saying, when David says his first line, everybody fall out of your chair laughing. So that was his, you know, welcome to the theater. Well, so cut to, we go through, and we have our very first preview, so we've never been in front of an audience. And you never know where the laughs are until you have an audience. And we get to that moment in the play, and I walk out and say my line. And of course, it had nothing to do with me. I didn't know what the hell I was doing. I was fresh out of school, but it's just because of the structure of the play. The whole audience went nuts and basically fell out of their chairs laughing. Well, I'm standing upstage looking down at my fellow professional cast members. They're all on the floor, you know, because of the staging, and they're all looking up at me. And when the exact same thing that happened in the rehearsal room happened in the theater, they just all started laughing in my face. And it was, I can still remember, I can still feel the sensation of biting my cheeks, because I was the only one facing the audience as this, whatever, 22, 23-year-old trying not to laugh while all these people are just going at them. So that was that. And we had, as you said, Richard, a preview period that was unbelievable. We had, it was so funny, and people, I remember, you know, we had older women hitting their heads on the seats in front of them. They were laughing so hard. It's a great scene where Kate McGregor Stewart is a therapist, and Jack Gilpin comes in as the lover of John Lithgow and talks to her. And she... I won't say the word here, but anyway, it's very funny. She can't figure out. She's totally clueless. And when it finally she realizes that the two of them are lovers, she's nonplussed. She can't believe it. And she pauses for a moment, and then she says, "No, it's fine, cocksucker." And then she says, "I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry." And then she can't stop saying it. And the crew used to gather in the wings to watch that scene every night because it was so fun. And the audience, it was so shocking. But Kate was so brilliant, too, that it was... But anyway, so we went on and on, and finally we had opening night. So opening night at the Brooks Atkinson Theater, and my mom and dad were in the audience. This, by the way, was the turning point for my mom and dad, because when I went to college, I had intended to be a musician. I was going to be... I played the piano. And they were so depressed about that. And... because they thought, you know, there's no career there, there's no life. And when I got to college, I realized, you know, I really don't have what it takes. A lot of my friends were actors. I got involved in the acting program. And so I called them and said, well, I have good news and bad news. And, you know, I'm not going to be a musician. I'm going to be an actor. And they were like, oh. Although I later learned my dad had always wanted to be an actor. And his, in 1932, when he got out of college, he was going to go to New York to be an actor. His dad said, depression, it's scary. Why don't you come work in the insurance office that he ran? Which he did. Met my mom. They got married. That was it. Went off to fight in World War II. He then continued to act in community theater in my hometown, which was before I came along. I never got to see him act. But... after he passed away, folks from the town came to see curtains, actually, and brought me a sheaf of reviews of him. And apparently, he was amazing. And in fact, one family friend who had seen him on stage and came to see curtains, she came backstage afterwards and said, oh my God, you're your father. So that was cool. Yeah, that was beautiful. So, And mom and dad were in the audience on opening night on Broadway, surrounded by celebrities. And they thought, oh, okay, well, this isn't so bad, actually. And afterwards, we had dinner at Sardi's, because that's what you do, or what you did. I think you can still do that. But so we went across the street to Sardi's, and the opening night party was half a block away at the Milford Plaza. And we're sitting there having our dinner. The New York Times review came out at 11, I guess, when it came out. It was Frank Rich, and he didn't like the play. I remember he said it was something like, these things stick with you, it was something like, one day the comic genius of Christopher Durang will burst on the Broadway stage, but not tonight. And yeah, and actually Frank is a friend, and that's what critics do, but I thought, wow, that's rough. And I hung out with my folks for a while, and I said, you know, I should probably get to the party. And I walked the half a block to the Milford Plaza and walked in the door, and it was empty. It was a lobby. They had cleared away the food. Everyone had left. Chris Durang and one friend, that's who was standing there. And I can still see that. And the next night, we had a performance, and no one laughed. And we ran 2 weeks, and we closed. And I remember the curtain came down on the last show, and I sat down on the stage and wept. I just couldn't believe it. But I now know, looking back, I got the entire package in one show. The heights and the lows, everything about what it is to be an actor in the commercial theater in New York, and I still loved it. So that's why I'm still doing it.
Yeah. Beautiful story. Thank you for that. So when you got to New York, you had some fun jobs early on, didn't you?
I was a hooker. I hate that you laughed. My first job was selling neckties at Bloomingdale's. Yeah, as Christmas help, as temporary Christmas help. And I was extremely bad at it. I didn't like asking people to do things that they hadn't planned to do. And also, as you can imagine, neckties at Christmas time are the last hope of very desperate people. So, and it was also Ronald, this was 1981, Christmas of 81. Ronald Reagan was president, so there were jelly bean ties. Ronald Reagan liked jelly beans, and there were all these neckties. I didn't want to sell those to people anyway. And I couldn't figure out, we had these computer cash registers that I could not figure out, and you're supposed to do they live in Canada, and you have to do the sales tax, and I know that there are, you know, Christmas gifts that are still somewhere waiting to be delivered because I was responsible for them. So I hated it. And then at the end of the season, they asked certain people to stay on because they were so good, and they did not ask me to stay on. And I was so hurt. And it wasn't even a job I wanted, but I thought, oh, man, thanks. So, and then the other gig I had, which was a long-term job, was I worked through a temp agency. I don't remember the name of it now. I don't know. Worked at a law firm. Chadbourne Park, Whiteside and Wolf. And I went, it was in Rockefeller Center, and I just went, you know, as a temp, but they were working on a case, it was a computer fraud case, and it was so involved and huge that it went on for years. And there was a group of us who, even though it was through a temp agency, we weren't employed as paralegals. The more we worked there, the more we knew about it. So they just kept having us come back, and it became my unemployment. I would just go, and they all came to see Beyond Therapy. I was there. I still have the yellow legal pad where I wrote down, you know, the information for the audition, and they were all excited for me. They all came and saw the show, and then when that closed, I went back to work at the law firm until I got my next job. And one more thing about that, I just thought about this, about the Beyond Therapy gig, that a guy just came to see Vanya, named John DeLeo, and John is a writer. He writes books about film, you know, greatest moments in film, things like that. But back in 81, end of 81, I was looking for work. I had just come to New York, and Robert Moss, who founded Playwrights Horizons, and he also ran this theater, summer theater up in Ithaca, and he knew I was a musician, and he knew I needed work, and he asked if I wanted to be the music director for the summer season up at Ithaca, and I said, well, sure. And we auditioned people, and the reason I know John DeLeo is I cast him as the MC in Cabaret that we were going to do that summer. And so we're all set to go, and then I get the audition for Beyond Therapy. And I was scheduled to start work up in Ithaca in June, and the play started previews in April and opened in May. And so I called Bob Moss. Now, I'm brand new to the business, of course. I'm brand new to New York. And I called Bob, and I said, okay, listen. I just got this Broadway show, so this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to tell him I can do it, but I can only do it for a month. And then I'll still be able to come up to Ithaca and be the music director for Cabaret. And there was this long pause on the other end of the phone, and Bob said, David, you're going to do the Broadway show, and we're going to find another musical director. And that was that. So that was a lovely thing for him to do.
That's a great story. You spent the early 80s doing a few seasons at Williamstown, at the Guthrie.
Yeah.
What did you learn creatively during those years?
Williamstown was an amazing, it continues to be an amazing place. I just worked there this past summer after many years away. What happened to me was the guy who founded Williamstown, Nico Sakharopoulos, was one of my acting teachers at Yale undergrad. He also taught at the drama school. And what he did every year was he'd take a few actors from his classes here at Circle in the Square and at Yale and bring them up as non-equity people for the Williamstown company. So in 1980, when I was a junior, he brought me up, and I was a cadet in Cyrano, starring Frank Langella and Laurie Kennedy. I got to be a play, the small part of Lexi Mill in Candida that Austin Pendleton directed, also one of my teachers, with Blythe Danner and Edward Herman, which is how I got to know Edward. What else did we do? I was Christopher Reeve's understudy in The Cherry Orchard, where he played Yasha. And in fact, my memory of that was he had one day where he knew he couldn't be there for rehearsal because he had to do the Today Show. So he was going to fly in to New York. So I was in rehearsal, and I was playing Yasha, and Colleen Dewhurst was playing Ranevskaya. Well, so I did a scene with Colleen Dewhurst, and I can still remember kneeling next to her. She was in a chair and looking into, it was like doing a scene with a lioness. I mean, it was so intense and extraordinary. But that's what Williamstown was for me. It was being, learning just by osmosis of being with these extraordinary talented people, and they went up and they did these great classic plays. Oh, we did The Front Page, that's right. And then the second year I was at Williamstown, I had the different experience, which is I was part of their non-equity touring company. And then it was just all of us non-equity people, some from Juilliard, some from Yale, all over. Many of whom, Michael Cerveris, I'm trying to think who else you would know, doesn't matter, but a lot of young people who went on to do something. And we did a mix of Shakespeare plays and The Inspector General and a new sort of weird theater piece by Tom Fontana. And we would get in a bus and tour around, perform at schools in the area. I remember, so we did The Winter's Tale, and I played Time. And David Schweitzer's brilliant idea, this is long before Laurie Metcalf did the other place or other places, was that when the audience came in, Time would be standing on an hourglass in the middle of the stage for the entire 30 minutes as a statue, because there's a whole theme in The Winter's Tale of someone being turned into a statue and then they come to life. So I had to stand on a damn hourglass. And this was, you know, we were in school, so high school students, and I was on the floor, and they'd walk by and, you know, say things and poke and everything. It was very frustrating. So anyway, so it was, that was a wonderful, the sort of two sides of the coin of the Williamstown experience, of being given the responsibility and independence of being leads in shows in a, with a group of young actors, and also being on the main stage the previous year and just being immersed in this great culture of, because the cool thing about Nikos was he believed that a summer theater didn't have to be lightweight and didn't have to condescend to the audience, that you could do The Cherry Orchard, or you could do The Greeks and put together this huge chain of all the Greek tragedies and dramas. And then that continued at the Guthrie. Once I came to New York, actually my first thing I went on, I did The Seagull. That was the first thing I did. I was at the Guthrie in 83, 84, and 85. I did The Seagull in 83, I did Tartuffe in 84, and then did The Season in 85. Liviu Chule was running the theater at that time. Great, great, great Romanian director. And something that has, I'm just realizing as I'm saying it now, been a recurring theme in my career is people who look at the theater as a place of great richness and depth, as opposed to a place of pizzazz and shine, which is not to say that it isn't theatrical. In fact, Liviu was extremely theatrical in his presentations. But he approached everything, even we did Midsummer Night's Dream, and it was funny, but it was Romanian funny, if you know what I mean, which is people who've been through a lot, essentially. And that was a great, rich experience. Also very sobering, I remember another Romanian, Lucian Pintilie, a great, great film director and theater director. He directed The Seagull and cast me as Constantine. And not long after I was there, I think probably the first day after the first read-through, we were walking down the steps together, and he said to me, "You should not worry that you were not the first choice." And I thought, I could happily have not known that. But that's so Romanian. It was very like, you know, yes, and then we die. So it was a wonderful international experience, too, because it was Leave You and yeah. because he brought in Luchan. So being exposed to that kind of, we did this production of The Seagull, it began with the fourth act. It began with the card game in the fourth act. And then became a flashback to the rest of the play. It took place on this big steel deck with these sort of rusting, stained mirrors upstage. And I remember Mary Beth Fisher was Nina, and I was Constantine. And first of all, you should know that as actors, that means that within 5 minutes of the audience sitting down, they are then going to see two highly agitated young people, one of whom is saying, "I'm an actress, I'm a seagull. I'm an actress, I'm a seagull." With no preparation whatsoever. There's no play that's gone on before because he's stuck the fourth. So we just felt like idiots. But in the other thing about it, which I remember, was that it was very high tech, and we had this steel deck, and he had this great fog that permeated the sort of flashback atmosphere, but it was oil-based fog. So our first technical rehearsal, we came running in to do this big scene, and suddenly it was the ice capades, and we were like down on the deck and spinning out on the floor, and it took a lot of arguing because he wanted to use that fog and he didn't want to change it, but we finally were able to, you know, convince him that the play just wouldn't work if we were spinning around like Torvald and Dean. But it was very interesting, and people had strong reactions. You know what else was great about the Guthrie, too, was the commitment of the audience. That was something that was very palpable. I remember after having spent the season there in 85, and I was at the bank closing my account, and an older woman was standing behind me, and I went and closed my account. Obviously, she heard what I was doing, and as I turned to walk away, she looked at me and she said, "We'll miss you." Yeah. And I thought, oh, wow, and that happens in New York, too. They don't usually say, "We'll miss you," but that wonderful thing, I remember this from the early days of being in whatever Broadway show, that people come up to you, and it's a whole different thing of being on a TV show and that kind of recognition. People who were in the theater, and the way they express themselves and what they appreciate, it is so meaningful, that actual personal connection.
That's great. Mm. You also play Laertes.
Yes.
Opposite Kevin Kline's Hamlet at
yes.
the Public.
Yes.
What are your memories of that?
Uh-huh. Well, that came out of Leave You directed that production. This was the first time Kevin did Hamlet. And he cast me as Laertes. He cast Harriet Harris, or Harriet Sansom Harris, if you know her. She's now in Cinderella. Wonderful actress. She and I had done Tartuffe together at the Guthrie. And she was Ophelia. Harris Yulin was Claudius, and Priscilla Smith, actress who also works a lot with Romanians, was Gertrude. And it was a very interesting lesson because Leave You was very much an auteur director, someone who had very strong visions about what a piece meant, how it should be done. And Kevin is not someone who responds well to auteurs. He quite reasonably felt, well, I'm playing Hamlet, and it's my first time in New York playing Hamlet, and I think I'm going to do it the way I want to do it. So pretty early on, I think the lines of communication between them stopped. So it was, I think, probably not a very successful production. I know that I got all the laughs that you can get as Laertes. And I also now know that you probably shouldn't be getting laughs as Laertes. But it's my instinct to look for them. And I do think, I mean, I think there were things... early on, I was drawn to the reality, the recognizable reality of what happens on stage. And so I think that I can say that the scenes with my sister were good, and with my dad, because I think we instinctively found the thing that people would recognize about what it's like to talk to your sister, or what it's like to have your dad tell you, you know, what the world is all about. And especially knowing, this is where I think, as an actor, part of my director brain was kicking in, which I didn't know at the time, knowing that he was going to lose his dad in the play and come back insane because he lost his dad. I knew it was important that no matter how frustrating the dad's, you know, to thine own self be true, all that stuff was, you had to see how much he loved his dad so that you would understand the loss. So I think that was a good thing that we did. And I will say this, we had a great sword fight. B.H. Berry was the choreographer, and Kevin and I, because I had done sword, at the Guthrie, I had done, we did a production of Cyrano in which I played Valvera, was that his name? Whoever it is, the guy who has the big fight that Cyrano makes the poem up about and then kills him. And that was incredible. And I also understudied Cyrano. And when we did Hamlet, I understudied Kevin. So I had to learn both sides of the fight. But this fight, this was a great fight, which ended up me with two swords battling him. And it was very exciting. So that was good. Oh, and the other thing I remember about that, this is important for any of you method actors out there. So our Laertes, Richard Frank, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful actor who has passed away. Horatio. It was very important to him. He's such an honest, real actor. And he said it was very important to him that when Hamlet died, that he would be able to cry about it. And he said, you know what, I can't cry 8 times a week. It's not going to happen. And it was in a small theater. And he said, but I want to be able to do that. So he had worked it out with Osric, the actor playing Osric, that Osric would have in the sword fight a little bit of Bengay in his hand so that Rick could just surreptitiously get it and, you know, do that so that at the right moment he'd be able to cry. There was one performance where he must have gotten such a handful because the whole theater smelled like a gymnasium and every single dead person on the stage was crying. We were all like, had these tears coming out of our eyes. It was a very athletic performance.
How do you pronounce your character's name again in that?
Laertes.
Okay, because I can't pronounce anything in Shakespeare, so I apologize.
Oh, that's okay.
I think
that's...
I called you Laertes or whatever. Well, that's, whatever
yeah,
I said. Well,
that's fine too.
Okay. That's great stories from that production.
Yes, well, exactly. There are others I won't be telling,
okay.
But that's, yeah.
Well, you returned to Broadway in the Heidi Chronicles.
Yes.
You got to work with Wendy Wasserstein.
Yeah, and that was also a lesson because I had been away. I had done, we had done a tour of the Cherry Orchard that had gone abroad. And so when the Heidi Chronicles was done originally off-Broadway at Playwrights Horizons, I didn't see it because I was away, and Boyd Gaines had played the part and won the Tony Award that they called me up about. And they said, well, do you want to come in and read for this part to replace Boyd? And I said, no. I mean, I'm sorry, I don't want to replace someone. That seems weird. And they said, you know, it's a pretty good part. You should probably look at it. And I said, oh, well, all right. Well, if you know the Heidi Chronicles, it's actually a great part. It's a beautiful part that Wendy based on her friendship with Christopher Durang, her best friend. And it's all of it. Some of the first meeting of the characters is actually taken from their first meeting. So just realize that connection. 6 degrees of Christopher Durang. So I ended up reading for it and getting it, and I had the best time. And one of the great things about it was it was a whole replacement company. So Dan Sullivan, the director, the first time I got to work with Dan, came back and actually directed us. And it was Kristine Lottie and Tony Shalhoub, Deborah Headwall, Amy Aquino. That's all I can remember right now. And it was a fantastic part. And I did it for 6 months, which was the longest I'd ever done a run. After Kristine left, Brooke Adams took over, and after she took over, she and Tony got married. So they fell in love on that set. But it was wonderful working with Wendy. It was wonderful working with Dan, And just to really be in the, because that was, at Beyond Therapy was my Broadway experience, which was 2 weeks plus previews. This was a successful show with a very joyous audience that loved it, a great part with a lot of heart and soul. It ended up being a template for the kind of roles I like to do, including on Frasier, which is definitely roles that are funny and supposed to be, but also that have some sort of real emotion and real... something real happening.
Yeah. You did the Norman Lear TV series, The Powers That Be. Was it with John Forsythe and Holland Taylor?
Yes.
Dynamite cast. That was very important with the future of your TV career, wasn't it?
Yes, it was important for a lot of reasons. It was, I had just gone, the whole reason I went out to LA was that my partner, Brian, who had been an actor, and he'd always wanted to try out being a writer in television. And I was happily here doing theater. I had done Heidi Chronicles. I did another Jules Feiffer play, Elliot Loves. Mm-hmm. And everything was going fine. But I thought, boy, if he really wants to do this, I got to see what LA's like. Because I have a sister who lives out there. I'd visited it, and I thought, I'm not so sure. So I went out for pilot season. And this was the pilot season. So I auditioned for all these shows, which I didn't get, like ER. And Chicago Hope, you know, that was the era of that. And the last thing I read for was this political satire called The Powers That Be, created by Norman Lear and David Crane and Marta Kaufman, who went on to create Friends. So, but this was not Friends. This was, but it was incredible. John Forsythe played a senator. Holland Taylor played his wife. Valerie Mahaffey played his daughter. I played her husband, a suicidal congressman. And Peter McNichol was in it, in the original pilot. Oh, it was originally called Love Child, and it was all about the fact that this senator had an illegitimate child that no one could find out about, originally played by Linda Hunt. who I had done the Cherry Orchard with. And that was, yet another lesson. Linda Hunt, one of the great actors of our time, and also extremely funny, and not meant to do situation comedy, because her timing is her own timing. And she, what makes her so magnificent is that she is present, and the sort of time, she defines time in a way, if you know what I mean when you've seen her work. And sitcoms can't really work that way. There's a motor underneath. It's not automatic, because those are bad sitcoms. But Robin Bartlett ended up playing the part when we did the actual series. And, it was another one where the audiences loved it, and we had a good time. We were on a half a season, and then we were slated to come back in the season. It was the year that Bill Clinton was running for president. And NBC took the show off the air and didn't put it on until after the election. And I don't know why. We all theorized that there was something political going on. But it was such a good time. Again, really good writing, very funny stuff. But John Forsythe really knew that something was up, because he'd done a lot of television, and he knew how shows that are doing well are treated, and the perks that happen, and the things that arrive. And we didn't know anything about that. And sure enough, they killed us. I thought, oh, great, I'm right back where I was with Beyond Therapy. Or I thought, I'm out of the theater, I'm in television world, same thing again. We were having a good time, the audience loved it, gone. But the combination of Heidi Chronicles and The Powers That Be are the things that got me Frasier. Because the guys who created Wings, David Lee and Peter Casey and David Angel, came to New York and saw Heidi Chronicles, which is where they found Tony Shalhoub and put him in Wings, if you remember that show. He played the cab driver. And then when they were creating Frasier, the casting director of Frasier said, oh, there's this guy who looks like Kelsey. And they were talking about maybe having a brother. You should maybe look at him. And she showed them tapes of The Powers That Be. So they had seen me on stage in Heidi Chronicles, and then saw the tapes of Powers That Be. And that's and what happened was I went in and met with Jeff Greenberg, the casting director, and the three creators of the show. And we chatted. And what they said to me was, well, we're thinking of having a brother. We know his name is Niles. All we know is that he's going to be a therapist too, that Frasier is a Freudian, so Niles will be a Jungian, and that Frasier went to Harvard, so Niles will go to Yale. And that's all we know. And I thought, okay, great. And I went home and my agent called, or I called my agent, and I said, well, it, you know, it seemed to go well. And she said, well, it must have gone well because they've offered you the part. And the two things that happened after that was I thought, wow, how great. And then I thought, wait, what part? I haven't even seen a script. I don't know what it is. And when they just delivered the script the night before the first reading and I read it, I thought, oh, this is terrible. That they've written two of the same character. Why would you do Frasier and Niles? They're like identical. That's not going to work, which is why I don't produce television shows. And then we went in and had the first table reading, and immediately it was clear. And I thought, oh, that's how that works. So,
well, you worked with the brilliant director Jim Burrows. Talk about, was the pilot where you sort of like wipe the chair? There's all these things.
That was Niles. Well, first of all, you should know the pedigree. Jimmy Burrows' dad is Abe Burrows, who wrote How to Succeed in Business and, yeah, et cetera. And so Jimmy started out in the theater as a stage manager, and he's one of the great directors of television. He cut his teeth directing Taxi. I think he may have even directed a Mary Tyler Moore.
He did.
That's right, that's right. So that's where Taxi he directed a lot of. Then he directed all of Cheers, virtually, and most of the first seasons of Frasier, all of Will and Grace. He's now... I don't know the name of the show. Anyway, he's very successful and very, very wealthy. But when we were having the very first scene between Niles and Frasier in the coffee shop, and we're standing up at the coffee bar and we're talking, we go to sit down at the table. And before we go to sit down, Jimmy says to me, hey, why don't you take out your handkerchief and wipe off the chair before you sit down? Which, if you've seen the show, became sort of a really iconic part of this character. He was so fussy, but it wasn't my idea, it was Jimmy's. And that was a real lesson to me as an actor about how to enhance character, but also as a director about how to enhance actors, and how a simple thing like that, different from saying, why don't you take out a handkerchief and you can wipe off the chair and be really fussy and do this and then wipe that up. And then no, he didn't do that. He just gave me the idea and let me run with it. And that's how that whole show evolved. I remember he would yell. There's a very interesting time thing that happens in the different media. You know, when you're in the theater, when you're in film, and when you're in television. They each have their own time restrictions and requirements. In the theater, there's that sort of thing that we all know, that about the third week, it just sucks. And that's what happens. And we all know it, and we all forget it until it happens, and then we all go, oh yeah, third week, right. In television, in sitcom television like we were doing, there's only a week to do stuff. So you can only go so deep in the rehearsal process. The depth in that kind of television, if it's the Mary Tyler Moore show or our show, whatever, comes from years and years and years and years and years of doing the show. That's where the characters deepen and the relationships between the actors deepen. And Jimmy was the one who taught me that, because he would yell when he saw me and Jane Leaves like rehearsing something. He'd say, stop rehearsing. Because he knew that it had to peak on the night we filmed it in front of the live audience. It was a microcosm of what it is to do a play. But you can't rehearse it like a play, because you'll beat it to death and then it won't be alive anymore. And embarrassingly, it is exactly the same strategy that they had to use with the dog. That the dog was a very smart Jack Russell Terrier, and the trainer, Mathilde, who was so good, knew that if he learned the trick too soon, by the time he got to taping, he'd be bored and he wouldn't do it anymore. So she would get him up to the point where he almost knew it, so that then in front of the audience, he'd get it, you know, three or four times in a row while they were filming, and then that was it.
Wow.
Oof.
Yeah. So at what point during the process were you comfortable with your interpretation of Niles? Was it early on? Being, you know, a stage actor, when you do a play, by the time you get on stage, you're happy with what you're doing. But when you're dealing with a sitcom that ran 11 years, and your character has many tics and quirks and just things that happen to them, like from the pilot, were you happy with him during the pilot?
Yes. The thing I had to get used to in the TV show is that it's a different script every week. And that was completely unfamiliar to me. So, and especially when we first started out, because it was kind of planning to be a more secondary character when they started out. So the pilot episode, I had wonderful stuff to do as it presented the character. And then a few episodes later, I'd have like one little scene and I'd be so depressed and I didn't know why. I realized it was because my life hinged on whether I would have some sort of fulfilling creative experience or just a little boop and be gone. So that took some getting used to. And ultimately, what happened was the reason I was able to be comfortable with and enjoy the character was that the writers continually were finding challenges and wonderful things to do deep into the show. So there was always something new that I could look forward to, especially as they started to, once it became clear what the relationship, not only between Frasier and Niles was, but frankly, between Kelsey and me, and how that played, and how the love relationship between me and Daphne played, which was, she was his housekeeper, and I was secretly in love with her, even though I was married. And so those things, and these great writers, would seize on that, because you're always trying to come up, I mean, to do, 22 episodes a year at least for 11 years is inhuman. And I think one of the great achievements of Frasier is, even though at the time you might get to a certain season and the critics who write in the papers would say, oh, it seems to have lost something, or, oh, they got Daphne and Niles got together and it's just not the same. Nowadays, pretty much if you happen to turn on an episode, it's pretty damn good no matter where in the run it is. And that's the writers. That's their commitment, and it was important to them. Yeah. They set a high standard for themselves.
Do you have a favorite episode?
No. I don't. I really don't. What was the one that came on the other night? It was this one, David Lloyd, who has passed away, was one of the great writers in television. He wrote the Chuckles the Clown Dies episode of the Mary Tyler Moore Show, where Chuckles the Clown is dressed as a peanut and is stepped on by an elephant, and Mary Tyler Moore is scandalized because everyone in the office keeps making jokes about it, and then cut to the funeral at the end where the minister starts talking about Chuckles, and she can't stop laughing. And it's one of the great things ever put on television. And a great example of not only a brilliantly skillful writer, but a writer recognizing the gifts of the actor and knowing what it would be like to see Mary Tyler Moore go through that, which is a big part of, any writing. Favorite episodes, that was actually not of our show. But it reminded me, because David Lloyd wrote this show called Ham Radio, which was an episode where Frasier does a radio play and everything goes wrong and we all play characters. Intricate farce. There's a lot of wonderful farces. The hardest thing to write and to perform that were done on that show. And one of the great things Jimmy Burrows did, we shot in front of a live audience, and when we do these colossal farces, there was one that took place in a ski lodge where everyone was in love with everyone else. And the ski lodge took up the entire set, and sometimes a scene would cut very quickly from one being shot at this end to a room down at that end, and so it wouldn't lose the audience's sort of attention. He would play over the speakers, he'd have Flight of the Bumblebee play as the cameras all moved down to the other end, so it would keep the suspense going.
What do you miss the most now not doing the series?
Money. No, it is, I have to say, and as far as acting goes, we are very well paid on Broadway, but it is shocking where they put the decimal points in this town. Yeah. And to be fair, it's all changed since I was in television anyway. The world has changed, the total financial climate has changed, and then that has changed too. And I'm kind of kidding, because I can honestly say that I loved doing that show, but I was no happier doing that show than I was doing Heidi Chronicles, or even doing, something at the Public, which doing Shakespeare in the Park, which paid nothing. So I miss my friends. I miss all those guys. I see them when they come into town, or if I'm ever in LA and we talk on the phone, or if I go to Chicago, I see John Mahoney, who played Dad. And I miss that, but nothing else. People say to me, oh, will you do another television show? And it's not that I don't like doing television shows. It's just that we did it. I won't talk about the end product. I'll just talk about the process for us. We did it as well as it can ever be done. It was so fulfilling. It was so enjoyable. And people said to me, well, what about a spinoff for Niles? It's like, a spinoff is usually for a character that hasn't had a chance to do everything. Niles got to do everything. It's not like he was a minor character. You know, it's not like he was Frasier on Cheers, who then gets to have a whole full life that you haven't seen. That Niles got to do everything. I did sword fights. I did, you know, silent comedy. I did Fell in Love and everything else. So I have fond memories, but I don't miss it.
And you worked with the best.
And I worked with the best on every level. That cast, the writers.
Well, let's get into some of your other theater work. You played Sir Robin in Spamalot.
Yes.
Spamalot fans? Now, you went after Spamalot, didn't you?
I did. When I was in L.A. doing the show, I would occasionally do benefits. They had the stage benefit out there, which is an annual thing for raising money for HIV/AIDS. And then they also had sort of their version of the Encores series called Reprise, and I did Boys from Syracuse. And is there more water anywhere? That would be fantastic. No, I'm not going to take your water. That's wrong. All right, well. And I enjoyed it, and I realized, you know, I started out as a musician. Thank you.
Thank you.
And I'd never done musicals. And I tend to want to do things I haven't done before. And so this was years before the show ended, but I thought, I want to do a musical. And so I started taking voice lessons. And also I was in that's a whole other set of stories, but I did a play with Uta Hagen in LA called Six Dance Lessons in 6 Weeks, in which I played a ballroom dancing instructor who had been a former chorus boy. So I worked with a dance coach to learn all the dances I had to teach and also to learn kind of Broadway dancing in case that ever was something that would come up in the show or I might want to, you know, just have it in my vocabulary just so I know, because, you know, people who are dancers move differently. So I had this in my head that whenever Frasier ended, I would want to do a Broadway musical. Cut to the last season of Frasier. I'm sitting in the green room on a rehearsal day, and I read the New York Times, and I open it, and it says, Mike Nichols to direct Broadway musical of Monty Python and the Holy Grail. Now, I had worked with Mike many times and adore him. I grew up on Monty Python. I remember when it first came on television in the States, which was when I was in high school, and I thought it had been written specifically for me to watch. I loved it so much. And I had wanted to do a Broadway musical, and I thought, okay. So I called my agent and said, just tell them, I don't care what the part is, I just want to be in this. And so they arranged a reading in New York of a company to see whether they thought this was a viable thing to turn into an actual musical. And many of the people who ended up doing the show, like Hank Azaria, were there. Hank was playing the John Cleese roles. And I was playing the Eric Idle roles. That's what they sort of thought I would be appropriate for. And sitting next to me at the reading was Eric Idle. So that wasn't hard. But we did it, and it went well, and they decided to do it, and they decided to cast me. So it was fantastic. I actually literally went from finishing Frasier, I think I had a month off, and then I went into rehearsals for Spamalot. So talk about nice work if you can get it. The other, in terms of going after it, how many of you know Spamalot or saw it? And, okay. So my big number was, you won't succeed on Broadway if you don't have any Jews. And incredible number. Well, that number was not my character's number originally. It was sort of unassigned. In the original script, that song was to be sung by an actor playing Frank Rich, the critic. He was to be sitting in the audience, and in the middle of the musical, he was supposed to stand up and stop the show and say, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. You should just stop this right now. it's not going to work. And from on stage, King Arthur says, why? And he says, well, and then he sings this song, and he goes from being in the audience and climbs up on stage and performs the number, and at the end of it, he's eaten by a monster. So, I, again, talking about my partner, Brian, I played him the song, and he said, well, you have to do that song. That's a great song. And I thought, yeah, it is. It's a patter song. It's really something that I would be good at. So I asked Eric about that. And they said, sure. And then he kept trying to figure out how to get Sir Robin off stage enough that I could change clothes, somehow become Frank Rich in the audience. How would you do that and not have the audience see? And he finally said, you know what? I don't see any way to do this and not lose too much of Robin. So what I'm thinking about is maybe there's a way for Sir Robin to sing the song, which is where he began to get the idea of them going on a quest to do a musical on Broadway, which is the entire second act of the show. And it just evolved in the writing, in rehearsal. And rare that, you know, usually shows have second act trouble. He actually came up with this idea that became the second act and the journey of the show. So that's... That was that.
What was it like working with Mike Nichols?
It's always been amazing. My first gig with Mike was as Bill Irwin's understudy in the production of Waiting for Godot that Mike directed at the Mitzi Newhouse with Robin Williams as Estragon and Steve Martin as Gogo, F. Murray Abraham as Pozzo. Yeah, I almost died because I was Bill Irwin's understudy, and Bill Irwin can do things with his body that I can't. I was doing it in the rehearsal. But that was where I think it was that my first sense of how Mike sort of allows a play to happen. He casts it, and he has such a gentle hand. And then I wanted to work on him several more times. Elliot Loves, the Jules Feiffer play that we did first in Chicago and then up at the what used to be Second Stage. I did this movie, Wolf, that Jack Nicholson did. Not a successful movie, but a lot of interesting stuff in it. And then Spamalot. And the wonderful thing about Spamalot, Mike basically didn't say anything for the longest time. And he let Casey Nicolaw, who was our great choreographer and now great director of Mormon and all that, do his thing and shape the big musical numbers, which was so much of the shaping of the show. He was very much a part of the overseeing of the writing, though. And the thing that he brought to it, the two things he brought to it, one, as he himself said, the gift that he brings to this is that he hates musicals. So it didn't have any of the kind of yada yada that a musical can have, because he had no tolerance for that. He was very interested in the funny scenes being genuine and letting the humor come out of that. And the other thing he brings is, I would almost say he's so sophisticated, so to say childlike isn't quite right, but a kind of childlike innocence about, he doesn't suspend his disbelief. So if it's not working, it's not working. A lot of us, especially as you get involved in the rehearsal process, you lose perspective and you start judging things relative to how they were instead of as if you had just walked in off the street. And I remember there's an incredible gag that they worked out with the Black Knight, which is where he gets one by one, all his limbs are hacked off until eventually he's just a torso. And right through previews, Mike would look at that and say, no, I can still see the string or whatever. And it was something that probably no one in the audience would see. He didn't care. And he didn't care how many times he had to ask for it. And that's why his shows are the way they are, because he has an eye for every detail and he cares about everything.
You know, it's interesting because you were all in Chicago and I was at a party in New York and Mike was in New York for this party. I think he came back to New York for like a week and a half or whatever. I thought to myself, how interesting that a big director would have a show in Chicago and not be there. But I guess he needed to step away from it, clear his mind for a bit, and then go back and just say, this works, that works, or this doesn't work. You know, stepping away from it.
Which is exactly what he did, because we had a big number for The Cow that got cut. Very sad, yes.
Yeah.
Sara Ramirez, who played, it was so good. Sara Ramirez, who played all the women, which, by the way, that's another story about that show, that those were all meant to be played by different women. And Sara read for each of them, and she was so good, they just turned to each other and said, well, maybe she should just play all of them. And she did. So she was the Lady of the Lake, and she did this, anyway, all this great stuff. But in the original, in Chicago, the end of Act One, the act ends with a cow being catapulted over the castle wall and landing on the knights. And so there was a big thing where the entire castle wall pivoted, huge, you know, expensive thing, and you were inside the castle, and Sara, dressed in a cow-spotted evening gown with a cigarette holder, did a sort of Marlene Dietrich, I'm so tired kind of number about goodbye, I'm singing goodbye to you as the cow before I am catapulted over the wall. It was hysterical. But Mike went away and came back and said, yep, it's funny, and the whole momentum of the show grinds to a halt and stops. And that's the other thing that Mike does, which I, as a now director and aspiring director, I hope I can learn from, which is, doesn't matter how much it costs. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work, and it's gone. The great thing that Mike said to us in Spamalot is everything that's funny goes, because we only want really funny. And that's what he did.
Yeah. That's why that show was brilliant.
Well, and the other thing he did, this was a real, this is something I took with me, I use as a director myself, and also with castmates in other shows I'm in. Once we were up and running on Broadway, about a month, huge hit, so successful. And he came in about a month later and he said, so here's the thing. Once you have figured out how to get your laugh on any given moment, what he called your favorite squeak and turn, you know, once you know how to time that, he said, then don't do that. He said, just one night, just don't do it that way. He said, you can always do it that way again. And what that does, so many things. First of all, it keeps a show from being calcified and empty. Because if you keep doing the same thing and you think, oh, I have to say it this way and I have to hit this word, you can't stay alive for a long run. But it also means that there's no such thing as an actor saying, oh, if he does that way, then I won't get my laugh. There's no such thing as your laugh. And I cannot tell you the number of times, including in the production I'm in right now, where someone I'm working with would change something and we'd lose a laugh, and I'd think, oh, you know, I wish, oh, all right. And then I'd discover a different way to respond, and we get a bigger laugh. And it would stay alive, and there was never that. And then suddenly people aren't on stage judging each other. They're on stage playing with each other. And you're not so precious about how you do things and stuff. Because also, you know, audiences are very different, and sometimes the same exact thing doesn't get the reaction. And we were just having this conversation about how, as an actor, do you respond internally when you don't get the laugh? And one way is to feel shitty and think, gee, what did I do wrong? And the other is to be liberated. And that was the ultimate thing that Mike's advice did for me, which is it liberated me from the audience so that I could be out there with you, but not dependent on you. And that was a big deal for me.
Sure. You won the Tony Award for Best Actor in a Musical for your role of Lieutenant Frank Chaffee in the John Kander, Fred Ebb, Rupert Holmes, and Peter Stone musical, Curtains.
Yes.
Brilliant. Memories of that, working on that?
Oh, wow. So
Song and
memories.
Dance Man.
Yeah, I have a lot of memories of that. And the first one is when they asked me to do it, and they sent me the music, and I still have the CD. There's a beautiful ballad in it called Coffee Shop Nights, and it's about this detective. And he's singing about what his day is, and he's singing to this girl who he's really smitten with. And it's the first song in a show that John Kander wrote both the music and the lyrics for, because in the course of before I became involved with this production, just before Fred Ebb passed away. So in the decision to go on with the show, John took over the role of writing the lyrics. And so I have the CD, and it's John Kander sitting at the piano singing this beautiful ballad, and I heard that, and I thought, well, wow, that's I would love to be part of that. And we did several readings of it here in New York, and then we did a full rehearsal here and went out to L.A. and did it at the Amundsen first. And My most important memory of the production at the Amundsen was the night that I almost died, which is not an exaggeration. It is actually true. I was there's a point in the show, in the second act, where for various reasons I'm up on a catwalk, and it's up on the big brick, you know, fake wall of the set. And what happens is, mysteriously from off stage, someone loosens a sandbag, and it comes and smacks me off the catwalk, and you see me fall. And as I'm falling, these drops come up from below, and suddenly it sort of filmically cuts to people dancing and rehearsing downstage, and then suddenly they start screaming, and this set piece that's supposed to come in, this giant globe, comes in, and you see that I've fallen onto the top of it, and I come in astride this globe and come down. Gigantic thing, you know. That's what's supposed to happen. So the reality of what happens is I'm on a wire, I get knocked off and fall, and it's, you know, it's about as far as like the top of that screen down. And the wire, you know, they bounce me so that I'm able to land. I jump onto the set, the sort of offstage part, in the wings part of the set. And the whole side of the set, as this drop is coming up and you're showing these dancers below, it goes up, like an elevator, up to the top of the theater. And then they fly me out. I'm in a harness with a wire hanging at the top of the theater, up to where the globe is. And the globe is this big round thing. It's got a seat on it, big iron post that goes up, and a big iron cross beam across. And I get myself into position on that, and at the right moment, they lower it down with me on it. And this one night, when Nancy Reagan was in the office, in the audience, it's unrelated, but she just happened to be there. She's a perfectly nice woman. I'm coming down, and what the wire that I'm on gets caught in the cable pulley system, but they don't know it because the guy down below is still feeding it out, so he doesn't know that it's caught. And suddenly I stop, and the globe continues down, and the iron cross piece catches my head, and it starts, and I have no sense of what's going on. I think actually that because there's no sort of sense of where I am, I think I'm going up. I don't know what's happening. And it bent me so far. I had for obvious reasons, had a hairpiece, and also, you know, a mic underneath it. It bent me so far forward, it ripped the mic off. And then fortunately, our stage manager, God bless her, Beverly Randolph, saw in an instant what was going on, stopped it. And I'm left hanging there like this, up above the stage. The entire rest of the cast is down below, like, looking, because they know what's wrong. The audience doesn't know anything. It's a murder mystery, you know, in a musical. So they think, oh, yeah, that's pretty good. And then they bring in the curtain, and never forget this, too, Michael Ritchie. Michael Ritchie, who's now the artistic director of the Amundsen, but for many years a stage manager, the first person on stage. He was sitting out in the audience, and he, just like our stage manager on stage, he knew instantly. He was up there. It was the first face I saw when I got down. They lowered me down. Took me to my dressing room. I was able to go on and finish the show. It turned out I had what they called it slow motion whiplash because my head had been stretched so far. So I had a lot of PT after that. But the difference between the stage manager stopping it and, you know, quite an unfortunate ending was nothing. It was like, so, and going on the next night, was especially hard because it's a musical, so there's music playing. And just like in a horror movie, I was up on the catwalk, I was fine, I was ready to go, and then the music started playing that was leading into the sequence. And I can feel it now, you know, that music. And I don't think I ever got over it. I remember the last performance on Broadway when I came down off that globe for the last time, and I thought, thank God. That's done. I never have to do that again. So that was, yeah, that's my memory of that. Yeah.
Love that musical. John Kander, dear friend of mine, Fred Ebb was just, and you were yes. Brilliant in that. Absolutely
well,
brilliant.
Thank you. That was really good casting because it was about a guy who loved the theater and could not believe his luck that he ended up smack in the middle of it.
Yeah.
And so I didn't have to act.
Yeah. You know, you started to talk about the great Uta Hagen. I sat with her for an hour one day down at the Lucia Lortel, and I was afraid to death. Because you read about these people that have such strong opinions, and you're like, have your stuff together and know what you're going to do. She was the nicest lady in the world to sit with for an hour.
Yeah.
What was it like doing six dance lessons in 6 weeks?
She was a force of nature. Yeah. She was 83 when we did that show. Yeah. And I remember I met her at Babbo, great Italian restaurant down in the village, which is just a block away from her her then apartment. And it was a two-person play. I was also extremely intimidated. I studied her book, Respect for Acting, in college. And I thought, this is very serious. I'm going to be on stage with her, and I can't be a student. I have to be an equal partner on stage. And I remembered the George C. Scott Patton, at one point he beats Rommel in a tank battle, and he says, "Rommel, you bastard, I read your book." So I thought, all right. So I read both her books, Respect for Acting and Challenge for the Actor, reread them, and went out to L.A., and we were rehearsing, and I was so surprised. She was lovely, and she had me out to her place that she was renting in Malibu, her little house, and made me an omelet. I remember that. But there were little things that surprised me. Like, we were in rehearsal. You know, you probably know the books, and the books are so much about the reality of theater and how you ground things and all that. And so we're in first day of rehearsal, second day of rehearsal, and she turns to the director and says, "If he does that way, I won't get my laugh." I thought, "Who are what?" I know the page of the book where it says, if you want something different from the other actor, don't ask for it, just try to get it through your acting. So I thought, okay. And then we had this moment where, so I play this young sort of obstreperous ballroom dancing instructor who's come to give her lessons at her apartment. I'm very difficult. And early on in the first scene, she decides she doesn't want me, and she goes to call my boss to have me fired. And this is how old this was, in the script, I put my finger on the button to cut off the phone so she can't make the call. And in the rehearsal, we did it, and she went on talking, and I did it a second time. And then once more we did it, and I did it a second time. And she said, "No, we're not going to do that. That's cheap." And I said, "It's not cheap. I'm trying to stop you from calling my boss, and this is rehearsal." And she looked at me, and she said, "Fuck it." And she slammed the phone down, and she stalked over to the desk in the rehearsal room, and she sat down, and she got out her cigarette. She lit her cigarette, and she's sitting there smoking, and she said across the table, she said, "I wish you would have some respect for me." And I walked up to the table, and I put my hands, I was furious, I put my hands on either side of her, and I looked her in the face, and I said, "As long as I live, I will never have anything but respect for you." And the stage manager said, "Let's take five." And then we just had it out. And what I realize now is that she was 83. She didn't know me. And I think so there was a like power vacuum there. What's, am I going to take advantage? Am I trying to undermine her? What's this relationship like? And I realized, oh, this could end right now. We could not have this production, depending on how this conversation goes. And I just stuck with it. And she was very defensive and very angry. And I was firm but reassuring that I wanted to work with her and all that. And we finally ended rehearsal. And she was putting on her clothes at the Geffen. And we strode out of the rehearsal room, still talking. And we strode, still talking, through the theater that's connected. And then out into the parking lot. And we're still standing there talking at her car. And by the time we finished the conversation, we were in love. And that remained true for every moment through the rest of that production. It remained true through when we were going to bring it to Broadway. It remained true when she had her stroke in October, which meant we wouldn't bring it to Broadway. And it remained through to the day she died, when I was the last person she spoke to. I called her from LA to say goodbye to her, and then she passed. And it was... I have a wonderful acting story from working with her, which was in the play, she and I, there's a scene where I'm talking to her about my mom who died of Alzheimer's. And although my mother did not have Alzheimer's, I did have Alzheimer's in my family. It's something I'm very familiar with. It's a disease I've, you know, dealt with a lot. So in sort of Uta Hagen terms, I didn't have to do a lot of substitutions. There was this speech, and whenever I did it, I would at a certain point become fairly emotional just talking about it. And it wasn't always at the same point, but relatively at the same point. So one night we're there, we're sitting on the sofa together, and I'm telling her the story about my mother and the Alzheimer's. And it gets to that part where the emotions start to kick in, and they don't kick in, so I keep talking a little bit. And they still don't kick in, and I keep going, and I think nothing's happening. And I thought, okay, I'm sitting this far from Uta Hagen. I can't pretend to be upset. That's like, you know, sacrilege. So I didn't know what to do, and I remembered in her book where she said, when you have an obligation, when the playwright has given you the obligation to be emotional, she said, all you can do is do your work. Do your work beforehand, all the background, all the everything, and then just play the scene and don't ever peg it to a particular moment or word, because that's asking too much. Just give yourself the freedom. So I said, all right. And I finished the story, bone dry, just told her about my mom. The next line was, I said, would you like a glass of water? And I finished the speech, and I said, would you like a glass of water? And I lost it. And curtain comes down in the first act, and we're walking off stage afterwards to go to our dressing rooms, and she says, that was interesting. That was...
Wow.
Do I have time for one more Uta story?
Sure.
This is the other thing. Second preview. So each scene, it's a bunch of scenes. Each one is a dance. Blackout. It's her apartment set, and so stage left is her kitchen with a door off stage, and stage right is the door to the apartment. And after each scene, she and I would retreat through our various doors to do the costume change, quick change for the next scene, because it was a different week. Second preview, we do the first scene of the second act. We go off, each to our own dressing rooms. I'm halfway through my change, and I hear this tremendous crash from the stage, and I think, well, I know it can't be Ms. Hagen, because she, you know, we're awfully off changing. I thought maybe, because there's people moving set stuff, I thought maybe it's the furniture or the sofa or something. So I send my dresser out to see what's going on. She goes out, she comes back in, and she says, it's Ms. Hagen. And I walk out, and what happened was, so there are, when the blackout happens, there are stagehands with flashlights at each of the doors so that we can, in the, you know, disorientation of immediate blackout, see where to go. This night, she had seen the lights that go up the aisle, and she had walked, and the stage was probably this high, 83 years old, and she had walked straight towards the light off the stage and fallen to the ground. So when I came out, the house lights were up. She was lying on her back with her legs elevated on the stage. There was a doctor with her. I thought she was dead. And they called, we were at the Geffen, right across from the UCLA Medical Center. So they were, you know, the emergency team was coming, but she was able to get up, and they got her to a room just off the, outside the auditorium. And we're there talking to her, and she wants to go on. She wants to finish the show. And I'm trying to explain to her that you know, no. And finally, the managing director of the theater says to her, look, all of these people will come back. We will get them tickets to come back and see the show. But we don't want you to just finish the show tonight. We want you to be able to finish the run. And she said, all right. And he left, and I'm sitting there alone with her. And she said, I just wanted to go back on so I could get my hand. And then the emergency team comes. We go across the street to the medical center, which is, it's a Saturday, a Tuesday night in LA, so it's all people who've been shot and, you know, horrifying emergency things. And Uta comes in. She's in her wheelchair, I think I wheeled her in. Other members of the crew are with me. And the guy behind the desk is asking her questions and says, do you have osteoporosis? And she says, if I had osteoporosis, they would have brought me over here in a dustpan. And my, So my last memory of Ms. Hagen there is we're in, they have a sort of central courtyard, outside courtyard, in the emergency room area. We're sitting out there. The gunshot victims are being brought in behind us. Uta's sitting there in the wheelchair, smoking a cigarette with her hat, telling theater stories to the rest of us while we, you know, and she went on the next night and she finished the run. So that was...
Brilliant. Oh, we have a little more time. Labette, brilliant. You, Mark Rylance, Joanna Lumley.
Yeah, that was a...
You did it in London first.
We did it in London first. That was a charmed thing.
It was, right?
Yes, although not critically charmed. That's another one that irritated me critically, but was such a wonderful experience. It was Matthew Warchus, this great director, who just directed Matilda, which got kind of good reviews today. Mark Rylance, one of the great actors ever. And this wonderful company of young actors, and Joanna Lumley and me, and we rehearsed it in London. It was, I remember the first time we did it, the producer, Scott Landis, asked me if I would, he had sent me the script, and he kept bugging me to read it, and I didn't read it, and I didn't read it, He said, look, Mark's playing his part, and you can have any other part that you want. And he was thinking, or I don't know, did anyone see Labette? Okay, so Joanna Lumley played a princess, but in the original script, it's a prince. And it was played by Dylan Baker on Broadway, famously as a fop. He got a Tony nomination, just a wildly eccentric, sort of with a cockatoo on his shoulder, and the world's longest ermine train and all this stuff. And I think probably that's what Scott was thinking of, but there was this other character who played opposite him, who was this very sober, intense guy who had this big sort of interesting speech at the end of the play, and I thought that's what I was drawn to. And we went over to read it through with Mark to see whether this was going to work. And Mark had just opened for the first time in the Royal Court in Jerusalem. This unbelievable performance. I didn't know anything about it. I just knew. And so we're there, and they've assembled just a group of random actors to read with me and Mark to see how it goes. And Mark doesn't show up. And it turns out no one told him that the reading was that day. So he had opened the night before in Jerusalem, this epic piece. And about a half hour, 45 minutes later, he comes in, and he was familiar with the play, but essentially sight read this extraordinary performance, and we hit it off. There was a great sort of back and forth, and that solidified it, and that's when we decided to do it. And blessedly, we did it first in London, which was such an adventure for me, and it was a long time, so I really got to feel like I lived in London, and that was wonderful. And then we came here, and it was magical. Actors would come back repeatedly to see it. It was such a great piece. And critically, originally when it was done, and this time when it was done, the thing that always amazed me about the play, about the reception, is that this is a play David Herson wrote entirely in verse, like a Moliere play, and not bad verse, brilliant, imaginative, inventive, extraordinary verse. And even the people who liked it, which was about half critically, took that for granted. No one, to my knowledge, ever said, how did he do this? And he wrote it originally, he was in his 20s. And I think in a way it was a backhanded compliment. He did it so well and made it seem so effortless that people took it for granted and didn't realize just what an achievement that was.
You know, we have a little time left. You work with some wonderful directors on film. Your last film, The Perfect Host, I loved. How many people have seen The Perfect Host? DVD, fabulous movie. You played a dark character in this.
Yes, it was a script that was kind of wonderful because it's a character, it's a guy who's getting ready for a dinner party. He's having a dinner party. And a very, very dangerous criminal talks his way into his home, mm-hmm. which is the biggest mistake that the dangerous criminal has ever made in his life. Because it turns out that the character, who in the beginning of the movie is very Niles-like, very, you know, a gourmet chef and sort of natty and all this, is completely out of his mind and delusional and sees people who aren't there and is vaguely homicidal and a nut. So it was the greatest thing for me to be able to do, because in one movie I could take people from what they were used to seeing me do and take them on a trip to something else. And it was also, it worked well for the film, because since most people who would see the film, all seven of you, would be familiar mostly with me from Frasier, you would imprint that on the character, and so you'd be lulled into a sense of, oh yes, I know what this is. So you'd be even more horrified when he turned so nasty.
Sleepless in Seattle, you work with the late, great Nora Ephron
yeah.
as a director. What was
yeah.
that like?
Oh, that was lovely. I was very young, and it was a very, you know, few scenes, but she was so gracious and extraordinary, and you know, she's a dear friend of Mike Nichols, so I've run into her many times over the years. And I think graciousness is the thing I think of her as a person, as a director, and as a writer. There's something so.
Little Man Tate, you got to work with Jodie Foster on screen and as a director.
Yes, and it was the first thing she'd ever directed, and that was cool. Diane Wiest was in it, which was nice. She and I sort of played opposite each other, and so that was like old home week. And what I mostly remember about that was, because Jodie had started in the business when she was basically in the womb,
yeah.
she actually came to this, her first directing assignment, as a woman at a time when that was not so common, with more experience than most people on the set. So all these big crew guys had a lot of respect for her, and she didn't have to do a lot to show she knew exactly what she was doing. And I loved seeing her be able to do that.
Yeah, we have a little time for some questions from the audience. Some you've already answered, but this is a really great one. Do you feel there are still glass ceilings for LGBT actors or members of any minority group? What are some of the changes related to diversity that you would like to see the industry embrace?
Wow. You know, I think there are fewer and fewer. Of course there are still, I'm sure, glass ceilings, and I think those situations are very individual. In terms of a given employer or a given production. But when I look at, you know, Neil Patrick Harris as an example of someone who is very openly gay and really rode that the crest of that wave of, let it really, of playing a straight role, you know, in a popular television show, kind of, okay, question asked, question answered. It's a fight for all kinds of minorities that continues to be fought and will have to be fought, because frankly, in a way, it's no different than the fight that any actor who gets identified with a role goes through. It's the nature of acting. One of the blessings of the theater is the people who go to the theater accept, understand, and look forward to the idea that someone they saw do something else a year ago is now going to be a completely different character.
Yeah.
Television doesn't tend to work that way. Film kind of does, depending on the actor. So I think it's, I think there are hurdles still to be gotten over, but I also think there is something endemic in the nature of any time you do something and it is indelible, then you have to find a way to work around it.
Sure. Is there a role or a character you would like to revisit because now you're ready to play it?
Oh, wow. That is a great question. Well, there's a... I don't really want to go back to this because I don't think probably it's a great play, and I think I would hate it even though I'd be better at it. But I did, the second play I did in New York was called Summer. It was by Edward Bond. It was the Manhattan Theater Club. Francis Sternhagen was in it, and Betty Miller. And I played this young leading man, basically. And I remember, Franny always reminds me of this, that I had one scene on a beach in a bathing suit. And the first time I put the bathing suit on, I walked into her dressing room and I said, "Do you think I've been miscast?" She never lets me forget that. But I also had a big speech, which compared to like what I'm doing now was not that big, but I was terrible at it. And now I understand so much more. I think, oh yeah, I know how to play that part, but I don't know that it would be worth it. So, I don't know. And also another answer to the question is, I think every time I approach a role now, I've learned so much more from all the things that went before that even though it's not literally going back to another role, it's going back to acting. And I feel like, hopefully, I bring more and know more and do less the more I do it.
Yeah. Was there any role that you passed on that for a hot minute you said, poor choice, I should have taken that?
No.
Okay.
No.
I saw Vanya, Sonia, Masha, and Spike. How are you managing to save your voice after that delightful meltdown?
You know, that's a really good question, and this is, I'll be very honest with you about this. It's like an 8-10 minute speech, and it's a rant. And we did it in Princeton and didn't have a lot of trouble with it. Did it at the Mitzi Newhouse and was starting to have a lot of real hoarseness. And the Mitzi Newhouse is 700 feet underground, so we all thought, well, it's probably just the whatever mold is growing in the wings of the theater there. but then even coming on Broadway, I was doing it, and people would come back, it would get very raspy. And it's not wrong for the character, because the character's not a public speaker, and he's very upset. But deep down, I knew, as an actor, the reality is, in real life, when you are genuinely upset, you use your voice very well. You connect in a way that nothing gets in the way. You don't tend to. And so I didn't know. I went to my voice doctors to see if I had some kind of crud. And Victoria Clark, a great, great, great singer, performer, is my New York singing coach. Not a lot. She doesn't teach a lot. But when I need something. And I went to her to be coached on a song and talked to her about what was going on, and it was very similar to something that she went through when she was doing Sister Act, and she recommended an Alexander Technique teacher. Alexander Technique, for those of you who don't know it, is all about alignment, and it's all about a very delicate way of making sure you use your body in the most efficient and positive way, I guess. It works for people who play the piano, it works for all kinds of things. And I had one 2-hour session with this Alexander teacher, and all the vocal problems disappeared. And it was all about, I was playing someone who's very angry, and it's very natural when you're playing someone who's very angry to do this. And on top of which, Kristine and I, sorry, long answer, but Kristine and I also have the same shoulder problem on opposite shoulders. And the whole first part of the play, I sit in this chair talking to her like this, and she sits in there. So those two things combined, by the time I got to the speech, I was like, but what it doesn't feel like you're tense. All you felt like was, gosh, I'm hoarse tonight. Oh boy, the air must be dry, I'm losing. And it all was about the larynx being out of place because of these very related but unsuspected tensions elsewhere. So that's how I'm now, and I'm much, much better at the speech now. And final acting thing about that too is, of course, a lot of that tension is really protecting you from the reality of the emotions of the speech. And once you start to get out of the way of that, things happen that you didn't expect. And I wrote this Alexander teacher, I said, I must tell you, as someone who is known for and prides himself on being a minimalist, I'm shocked to see how much I was doing, even in something like that. And it was a great lesson for me. And at this benefit Monday night, it was a benefit for the Sundance Theater Institute. Robert Redford was on video speaking, and he said this thing about, you are never too old to learn something valuable. And that was the example I thought. I thought, yeah, here I am, 50, 100 years old, but I just learned something about vocal technique and emotion on stage.
Sure. Is there any mentor in your career before you became a name?
All of them. You learn from everyone. I have learned from everyone. I've learned from people who were consciously mentors, who actually, you know, gave me advice, but also, you know, you just learn, if you're open to it, you learn so much from people doing things badly, you know,
yeah,
right? And doing things well. So I have been very blessed with the people I have worked with. I've worked with the best, not by conscious choice, but a little bit. Things that sounded shabby or cheap or kind of low rent didn't interest me. And sometimes it didn't matter what the project was. If it was something, well, for example, when we were talking about this play, Six Dance Lessons, and the director's trying to come up with an actor, and he said, we're thinking of asking Uta Hagen. And I said, well, here's the problem. If she won't do it, I won't do the show. Because I knew instinctively that the play, it's a lovely play, but it's a lightweight play. Mm-hmm. She brought, and I knew she would, a weight and a depth to the play, to the experience, and to the experience. And that's what I'm always drawn to. And if I would say, if there's any part of whatever talent I have, it's the talent for knowing who to work with and being drawn to these great people that I know will enrich my life.
Yeah. What's the best way to find an honest agent? And what amazes me with you, you have the same agent, don't you?
I did.
Okay.
I did. Well, she retired. That's the only reason. Yeah, I had the same agent. She came up to me at Sardi's with my parents on the opening night of Beyond Therapy and said, my name is Marilyn Zatmary and I'd like to represent you. And I thought, who the hell is this? And the stage manager said, no, she's the real deal. And I was with her for 30 years. She retired and now I'm with, very happy with the folks at William Morris. But I was very lucky, you know. It's like getting a Broadway show as my first job. She was someone who I trusted. That's it. As someone who I trusted. I guess that's, you just have to go on your instincts. I don't, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. I know, I can tell you this, that like when I was looking for, back in the negotiating days with Frasier, where they were playing hardball and I was trying to find an attorney to, I met with a bunch of attorneys and all the ones who said, we are going to get you so much money, we are going to make them crawl. I was like, no thanks.
Yeah.
And then the guy who said, you know, this is what I think is fair. This is sort of the industry standard. This is what people have paid, and I think you deserve this for these reasons. I thought, that's my guy. And I ended up very happy with him and also happy with myself that I wasn't trying to, you know, screw people.
Yeah. In a day and age where a lot of big-time plays, movies, and TV shows seem like poor-quality entertainment, what would you say to an aspiring actor debating whether it's worth jumping through all those hoops to get there and try for a career?
There's always Shakespeare, and there's always Chekhov, and there's always Mike Nichols. There's always quality. There's always what you bring to it. I think that's what determines the experience for you. I think you can go into a situation where it could go either way, and it could become cheap or it become valuable. And ultimately, the responsibility is your own. You can whether it closes in 2 weeks or not, it can be a very profound and important experience for you, and you can bring a lot to the other people involved. That's what I would say.
My final question is, what is the best bit of advice that you were given that you still live by today?
Wow, that's such a broad question. Well, good old Mike, when we were doing Spamalot, said, if they're not laughing, do less. So I would say that.
I thank you very much for sitting with us this afternoon. Let's hear from Mr. David Hyde Pierce.